actually see this? Oh no, here he comes. Where's Busby? So, Susan is not coming back. So we're going to have Jacob and what's the new lady? Sonia?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's what they said. It's like, we're going to see how this goes. I'll be doing it. The roll call and the... They were asking me the same thing that we were talking about. It's like, now how do these minutes go usually? So now we got somebody else who I'm really going to have to... It's like between her and... All right, we're getting ready to have fun. 5:28. Okay, here comes Patrick and company. How are you?
Fine.
Great, great. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Durham Planning Commission. The members of the Durham Planning Commission have been appointed by the City Council and the County Board of Commissioners as an advisory board to the elected officials. You should know that the elected officials have the final say on any issue before us tonight. If you wish to speak on an agenda item tonight, please go to the table to my left and sign up to speak. For those of you who wish to speak, please state your name and your address clearly when you come to the podium. Please speak clearly and into the microphone. Each side, those speaking in favor of an issue and those speaking in opposition to an item, will have 10 minutes to present for each side. The time will be divided among all persons wishing to speak. Finally, all motions are stated in the affirmative, so if a motion fails or ties, the recommendation is for denial. Thank you. Can we have the roll call, please?
Certainly. Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. Commissioner Alturk?
Present.
Commissioner Johnson?
Present.
Commissioner Ghosh?
Present.
Commissioner Bryan?
Present.
Commissioner Whitley?
Present.
Commissioner Harris?
Present.
Commissioner Busby? Chair Hyman?
Present.
Commissioner Miller?
Here.
Commissioner Kinchin?
Here.
Commissioner Hornbuckle?
Present.
Commissioner Van?
Present.
Commissioner Gibbs?
Present.
And Commissioner Freeman?
Present.
Thank you. statement for March 14, 2017. Can I question Commissioner Bryan?
Madam Chair, I have a correction on the minutes on page 4 under the Watkins at Witherspoon case. The motion that appeared in the is shown in the minutes is to approve the case, and that motion carried 8-3. I think there was some confusion because there was also a motion to defer the case, which was failed 3-8.
Thank you. Are there any other corrections to the minutes?
Just one observation. My comments was not included in the March statement.
Are there other comments concerning or corrections for the minutes? So corrections and comments will be duly noted. So I'd like to have a motion to approve the minutes and consistency statements for March 14 with the identified corrections and adjustments.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly seconded, moved by Commissioner Miller, seconded by Commissioner Bryan, that we approve the minutes of the and consistency statement with corrections for the March 14, 2017 minutes. Are you ready for the question? All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 14-0.
The next item, adjustments to the agenda.
Good evening, Madam Chair. I'm Scott Whiteman from the Planning Department, temporarily filling the role of Grace Smith. We have two requests for adjustments. One is to, under unfinished business, to add a recommendation on the Planning Department work program. And then under new business, as we had sent to the Commission earlier this week, we would like to add a preview of the Durham Bike Walk Implementation Plan.
If I may, Madam Chairman, is there not also to be a change or correction to the January minutes?
That's correct. My colleagues are whispering loudly in my ear that we need to add that as well.
Is that another item for unfinished business?
Yes, right. A correction to the January minutes, which you should have found at your place on the dais.
Thank you. Our next item is...
Madam Chairman. Yes. I move that we adopt the agenda as modified.
Second.
Thank you. It has been motioned by Commissioner Harris and seconded by Commissioner Busby that we approve the agenda as modified. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand.
Motion carries 14-0.
Thank you. Thank you, David. The next item, public hearing, comprehensive plan, future land use map amendments. Staff, please.
Madam Chair, before you open the public hearings, let me certify for the record that all notification has been carried out as required by law, and affidavits are on file to that effect.
Thank you.
And the first case will be under item 8, public hearing zoning map changes. Case Z1624.
Okay, the first one is... Okay, the continuance. Yes, okay.
Hi, good evening, Jamie Sunyak with the Planning Department. This matter was continued from the February 14th hearing, and there have been no changes to the application. I believe there are representatives from the applicant here that may wish to speak on the topic, which was there were some comments from the adjacent school across the street.
Thank you. We will open the public hearing. I have two individuals who have signed up to speak. Chris Mel, 4, and with Eden Land, and then followed by Jeff Ammons, 4. Thank you.
Good evening.
My name is Chris Mail, Director of Civil Engineering Services with Eden's Land, 2314 South Miami Boulevard, Durham. As you recall, 2 months ago, we were here to speak about this project. There was some discussion regarding the neighboring Montessori school and their entrance. Since that time, my client, MI Homes, has met with representatives from the Montessori school, also with NCDOT, both the district office and a representative who reviews all school projects for NCDOT. And the parties have come to an agreement. It involves an extension of the center turn lane, which will allow better turning movements both into the proposed Andrews Chapel development and into the neighboring Montessori school. I believe they're on board with what we're proposing, so I'll allow Jeff to speak.
Hey, my name is Jeff Ammons. I'm here as a representative for the Montessori School of Raleigh. My address is 4821 Boulder Creek Lane in Raleigh. 60 days ago, approximately, y'all gave us homework when MI Homes came with their rezoning request. And as part of that, they have been very good to work with us, and we've met with DOT. We had an issue about the driveway not lining up with ours, but we've worked with DOT and have a great resolution. We're extending the turn lane, so I just wanted to be here to show our support for that project and thank them for working with us.
Thank you. I have no other individuals signed up to speak, so I'm going to close the public hearing and give the commissioners an opportunity to ask questions. Do I have commissioners who would like to speak? Okay. Only one. Commissioner Brine.
I have a very minor question. It's on attachment 7, table 2. I noticed that the zoning in each case for each one of these is slightly different, but somehow it's producing the same number of single family homes and townhomes. And is that really correct?
Yes, Jamie Sonyak, Planning Department. The number of residential units has not changed, but as I noted during my presentation in February, there has been a state statute that amended the way that we can calculate the density, and stream buffer areas can now be included as part of the calculation. So the number, the density number is different, but the actual number of units is the same.
It's change of a different factor.
And I just thought that since we were changing, we were doing this to allow them to have more townhomes and less single family, is that not?
They are adjusting the range for the townhomes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Are there other commissioners who would like to speak? Commissioner Miller.
The center turn lane that you're proposing to lengthen, it's one that you had already committed to, and this is an Andrews Chapel Road. The lengthening will allow more left-hand turns to be stored. Can you tell me how much longer it will be?
Approximately 100 feet.
All right. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Commissioner Harris.
Madam Chair, if I'm in order, I'd like to move that we send forward approval of zoning case 1600024.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Harris, a second by Commissioner Brine, that we move Andrew Chapel Z1600024 forward with a favorable recommendation. Are you ready for the question? All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand.
All opposed. Put your hand down.
Okay. Motion carries 14 to 0.
Thank you, Jacob.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item we have on the public hearing is Fletcher Mills, item number Z1600034. Our staff report, please.
Madam Chair, before we open the public hearing, I'd like to inform the Planning Commission that my firm has been engaged on that matter, so I'd like to recuse myself.
Madam Chair, I move that we recuse Commissioner Gooch.
Second.
I need a second.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Harris, second by Commissioner Busby, that Commissioner Gooch be recused himself from this proceeding. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Thank you. Now, Jacob.
Thank you. Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. This is request for case number Z1600034, also known as Fletcher Mills. The applicant is Stephen Dorn with McAdams. This is a case that is located within the city of Durham's jurisdiction, and the request is to rezone approximately 35 acres from residential rural to planned development residential 1.964 for a potential maximum of 68 single-family residential structures. The subject site is noted here on the context map. The left-hand side is the current or existing zoning, and the right-hand side shows the proposed zoning. The surrounding properties are also zoned RR, and as you can see from the map, there are some PDR zonings, as well as some RS-20 to the north of the site. Please note that, as you can see, the entire parcel is not included in this rezoning request. There is a corner of the southeastern part of the site, which is located in the FJA watershed district, which is not part of this request. The existing conditions sheet, as noted in the development plan as part of your packet, you see the site fronts along Fletcher's Chapel Road, as well as some environmental features. There's a riparian feature in the northeast corner of the site, and some wetlands along the southern border of the subject site. So standards for the PDR district. As I noted, the site is approximately 35 acres. The applicant is requesting a density of 1.964 dwelling units per acre. They're proposing a maximum of 35% impervious coverage, committing to 25% of tree coverage for the site, and a maximum building height of 35 feet. The proposed conditions, which is their development plan sheet in your packet, also notes access points, potential access points, riparian features, as well as riparian buffers, as well as some potential street improvements. A summary of some of those commitments, as I noted, 68 single-family units. They have committed to detached single-family units, project boundary buffers, the tree preservation areas. Wetlands are noted on the site, as well as required riparian buffers. The applicant is committing to three potential points of access, a left turn lane on the southbound portion of Fletcher's Chapel Road, as well as a bicycle lane along Fletcher's Chapel. The future land use map in this area calls out the area requested for rezoning as very low density residential, which is two dwelling units an acre or less, and that designation is found in the majority of the area. Areas to the east of this site are rural density residential. There's also a small portion of recreation open space on the subject site. Comprehensive plan policies, some of the policies that staff reviewed this case against, as you can see, contiguous development, infrastructure, school level of service, and staff found that the request was consistent with all of those policies. And finally, staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies and ordinances, and I'm happy to answer any questions you all may have.
Oh, no, I have them. Open the public hearing. I have one individual signed up to speak for, and that's Mr. Patrick Biker. How are you this afternoon?
Doing very well. Good evening, Chair Hyman, Vice Chair Busby, members of the Planning Commission. My name is Patrick Biker. I live at 2614 Stewart Drive here in Durham, and I'm with Morningstar Law Group. I'm here this evening to represent Shamrock Capital Partners, which is the owner and ground developer of this location. As you've just heard from Mr. Wiggins, this is a very low residential density development. We really don't have a whole lot to add onto what Mr. Wiggins has just presented for the commission. So I would like to introduce our team here from McAdams. Stephen Dorn and John Moore are the land planners and engineers for this site. So if you have any questions, we'll be happy to answer them. But knowing that you have a lengthy agenda tonight, we'll be happy to just forego our 10 minutes of fame and let it go at that. We respectfully ask for your approval. And again, as you can see, it's less than 2 dwelling units per acre. And we think it's the right fit for this location. Thank you.
Thank you. I do not have anyone else who is signed up to speak, so I'm going to close the public hearing and give commissioners an opportunity to ask questions. Do I have commissioners who would like to speak to my right? Do I have commissioners who would like to? Okay, thank you. Missed you. And other commissioners who would like to speak? Okay, Commissioner Miller. Commissioner Al Turk.
Thank you, Chair. I wanted to just bring up a comment that was made by the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission. They recommended that a text commitment be made to extend the sidewalk along Fletcher's Chapel Road. I know it is an off-site commitment to the intersection of Fletcher's Chapel Road and Sweet Road.
Unfortunately, this is an old ditch section, NCDOT Road. We don't think there's existing right of way in which to put the sidewalk. If you go out there, you'll see that it's a road. I think Commissioner Gibbs knows better than anybody. Been here for a long, long time, and we do not believe there's existing right of way in which to install the sidewalk. And also, if you looked at the location, in my experience, NCDOT would not allow a sidewalk where there is not any curb to prevent vehicles from crossing over onto the sidewalk and putting pedestrians in danger. So that one I do not believe is feasible. Thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Patrick, I'm sorry you sat down. Can you tell me why you cut the corner of the property off and left that one corner RR? I know you weren't going to be able to build on it, but it seems to me it would have added to your density calculation.
To be perfectly blunt, it was in the stream buffer. It was in the FJA area, and so it was only 6% impervious surface that was allowed under the UDO, and so we felt it was just a good environmental stewardship to leave it undeveloped and go with the 68 units. We thought that was the right density for this location.
And if I may, I'm going to vote for this, but I would have liked to have seen some design commitments here, especially some guarding against the repetitious placement of garages and visual monotony. I realize, though, that with so much of this property being buildable, that means that your average lot size will be larger than we have seen in cases in the last few years. Yeah. So maybe it's less important.
By today's standards, the lots will be fairly large. I think that's a good point, because a lot of times the lots are relatively small. But given that this is a PDR 1.9, it does give us flexibility for varying the street setback.
I would have liked to have seen commitments like that, but their absence in this case is not going to cause me to vote against it. And I did want to say that I also made the same observation that you did, without any right-of-way reserve to put that sidewalk in. Yeah. I mean, we've had other cases where developers have committed to put sidewalks that were conditioned upon making agreements with other property owners who were not part of the case, only to have them come back after good faith efforts and have to amend their development plan commitments. I don't like those enterprises, and so I don't blame you for refusing this one.
An additional problem at this location is the surrounding areas outside the city's jurisdiction. Therefore, I don't believe the city would be willing to use eminent domain if it were needed for a sidewalk.
Thank you. Do I have other commissioners who would like to speak? Did you have some additional comments, Commissioner?
Okay. No, I was going to make a motion.
Commissioner Gibbs, the chair recognizes Commissioner Gibbs.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think this site has some has some challenges, but it's the kind of site that I think lends itself to what could be an attractive settlement or neighborhood, I should say. I don't think we need to worry about there being that many long, straight streets according to the way the contours are, but I do appreciate the adherence to all the regulations for riparian buffers, and it was a good move on just eliminating that little piece of land that is really not buildable, like you said, but that's this is the kind of thing that I've been looking at for the last so many, for a long time, and it's become more and more evident within the last week. This whole area from Wake Forest Highway down through Mineral Springs Road and on beyond has built up so much, and stormwater, taking care of stormwater on the higher elevations has been great. In some areas, which has nothing to do with this project, because I'm satisfied with this project. It's on some high ground anyway.
Thank you, but Commissioner Gibbs.
Thank you.
The chair will, if there are no other commissioners who would like to speak, the chair seeks a motion.
Madam Chairman, I move that we send case Z-1634 Fletcher's Mill forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller, second by Commissioner Busby, that we send Fletcher Mills, item number Z-1600034, forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let's have a roll call, please.
Commissioner Alturk?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Brien?
Yes.
Commissioner Whitley? Commissioner Harris?
Yes.
Commissioner Buzzy?
Yes.
Chair Hyman?
Yes.
Commissioner Miller?
Yes.
Commissioner Ketchin?
Yes.
Commissioner Hornbuckle?
Yes.
Commissioner Van?
Yes.
Commissioner Gibbs?
Yes.
Commissioner Freeman?
Yes.
Motion passes 13-0.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda is Carillon of North Durham, item number Z-1600031. Staff report, please. And the list. Thank you.
Good evening. Jamie Sonyak with the Planning Department. I will be presenting case number Z-1600031, Carillon Assisted Living of North Durham. The applicant is Tony M. Tate Landscape. The application is located within the city's jurisdiction. The request is to go from residential suburban 20 to PDR 3.906. The site is 13.34 acres, and the applicant is proposing a congregate care facility with 56 rooms. As shown on the context map, the parcel is, the site is two parcels. The address is 4112 and 4214 Guest Road, It is located on the east side of Guest Road, just north of the Rose of Sharon Road intersection, and the case area is shown in red. The site is located within the suburban tier and within the Eno River EB Watershed Protection Overlay area, and it is surrounded by the RS-20 zoning. The aerial map shows that the property is located adjacent to single-family homes to the east and to the west, and there's a small commercial node at the corner of Guess and Rose of Sharon Roads to the south. It is just south of the Eno River and West Point on Eno Park. The existing conditions map show that the property contains a single-family residence and several accessory structures, all of which will be demolished. The remaining area contains a mixture of pine and hardwood forests, along with intermittent stream and a linear wetland, as well as the Middle Eno River Bluffs and Slopes Natural Heritage Area located in the northern portion of the site. The site satisfies the criteria for the PDR district, which includes a requested density of 3.906 dwelling units per acre, a commitment of 56 units, a maximum hard surface of 24%, a committed tree coverage of 20%, and a maximum height of 35 feet. The proposed development plan commits to the type of development, the number of units, the location of the building and parking envelope, the general location of tree protection areas and riparian buffers, the natural heritage area reservations and access points. These are also shown within the development plan as text commitments and graphic commitments. In terms of the design commitments, design commitments include the building being described as an American traditional style with pitched roofs, clapboard and shingle siding materials. The main building will utilize gable ends and other architectural details to provide visual interest from the front. The building will be residential in nature and blend in with the residential properties within the area. The future land use map, as shown here, indicates the request is consistent with the existing future land use, which is identified as low residential development for dwelling units or less. Staff has determined that the proposal is consistent with the comprehensive plan in terms of being a contiguous development and compatible with the surrounding uses. There is adequate water, sewer, and roadway infrastructure to support the development. The development is clustered to avoid disturbance of the natural heritage areas, and the proposed traffic generated from this proposal will decrease compared to the present zoning designation. The request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other policies and ordinances, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have at this time.
Thank you. I do have two individuals who have I'm going to open the public hearing and give two individuals an opportunity to speak. First individual is Tony Tate. And Bob, is that Stinson?
Stinson.
Thank you.
I may need some IT help here.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. My name is Tony Tate. I'm a landscape architect and land planner here at 5011 South Park Drive in Durham. Here tonight representing Carillon Assisted Living of North Carolina, and I've been happy to be a part of a large number of their facilities. It's over 22 across the state of North Carolina, and we've been a part of the majority of those in design and in development. So happy to be a part of that group of the developers. Carillon Assisted Living is just that. It's assisted living for the elderly that need assistance, and Mr. Steenson will be able to talk about the ins and outs and everything about their development and their business. The project before you tonight is on Guest Road North. It's right at the intersection, or just north of the intersection of Rosa Sharon Road. It is a piece of property that is much larger than what it takes for us to build one of these facilities. It's typical on one of our sites to take up about 3 to 3.5 acres of land. There are a couple other sites that we have that are larger, one in Knightdale, and the other one that is operated here in Durham over on Garrett Road is on about 12 acres. And so the amount of area it takes is about 3 acres of that. So this particular piece of property is much larger than what we typically take up. And so on this scenario, it's good for this project. This is another screen view showing the existing conditions. Back on the back side of the site, there is a natural heritage area on the back, and we've shown on the development plan to stay out of that area. There's a stream buffer back there. There are steep bluffs and slopes back there. There are significant trees back there on the back, and so we're staying completely out of that area. When we walk that site, this is kind of what it looks like back there on the back, and so we're staying completely out of that area, and we'll concentrate our development up front. So most of the traffic facilities out there have been upgraded. It's a four-lane median divided road. We'll have our entrance that comes in across from Old Road there. There's already a median break there. There's left turn lanes, and so we'll enter the site there and create as small a footprint as we can. We're not looking to go out there and develop the whole site, and so we'll have a minimal footprint out there on the property. As you can see from the pictures, it's a nice facility, and again, have a long track record in North Carolina with these facilities. So with that, I think I'll let Mr. Steenson speak now and kind of talk about Carillon Assisted Living.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. My name is Bob Steenson. 4901 Waters Edge Drive in Raleigh is my address. Carillon is a local North Carolina company. We were founded in Raleigh, and we're based here. Our closest facility is here in Durham on Garrett Road. We have been looking for a site in North Durham for some considerable time, almost 4 or 5 years now, to find a piece of property in the right place and of the right size, and we think we found it here. Carillon is a very quiet use. There's fewer things out there that are quieter than an assisted living facility by about 8 o'clock at night. It's a very low traffic use, as virtually none of our residents will drive. There is a strong need for assisted living in this part of Durham. I just pulled some 2017 demographics today, and there are 5,782 seniors age 75 and older in the 5 mile radius around this particular site in North Durham. And there are only 296 licensed assisted living beds to serve that size of community. And only 20 of those assisted living beds are dedicated to folks suffering from Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia. The Carillon facility will add 84 new beds to that total, and 48 of those beds will be dedicated to caring for folks with Alzheimer's disease. So in short, we think we found a good spot and a good fit. In addition, we do bring to the neighborhood, when the facility is fully occupied, 55 to 70 good jobs in the location. So the site, as Tony mentioned, we are preserving 30% of it from development as tree save and natural heritage. It's 4.2 of the acres. And as he also mentioned, the footprint, this is going to be a single story building, as you've seen in the photographs, roughly 35,000 square feet in total. We don't produce a lot of parking because we don't need a lot of parking. So the buffers to the surrounding neighborhoods are going to be, by definition, quite large. So I thank you for your consideration, and I'm available for any questions that you may have.
Thank you. I do not have other individuals who have signed up to speak for, so I'm going to close the public hearing and give commissioners, is there somebody else?
This gentleman I know came on this case, and I was just wondering if he wanted to speak.
I do not have other individuals who have signed up to speak, so I'm going to close the public hearing at this time and give commissioners an opportunity to ask questions. Are the commissioners to my right? Okay, Commissioner Ghosh.
You've also got Johnson.
Ms. Commissioner Johnson. Okay. Commissioner Miller. Commissioner Gibbs. And Commissioner Freeman. Okay. Okay, let's start with Commissioner Johnson.
Thank you, Chairwoman. Just a couple of questions, mostly out of curiosity for the Mr. Tate. So first, thank you for coming in and speaking on the project tonight, this evening. I'm curious as to what's the average size of a unit in a facility such as this?
That might be a better question for Mr. Steenson, knowing the inside.
Most of the rooms are studio rooms, Commissioner, and they average around 300 square feet. Right. So they're not dwelling units by definition of the building code. It's a bedroom with a private bath. So they run about 300 square feet. All dining is done centrally.
Gotcha. Thank you. And follow up? And my second question is, I may be missing it on the plan map, but is the plan for the saved wooded area to keep it as like no barrier towards the developed piece, or is there going to be some kind of, I don't know, some barrier or something to?
We would have all of the required tree protection fencing and everything to preserve all of the areas back towards the Eno River. Mm-hmm. So all that stuff would be protected and no development back there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just wanted to express my support for this case. I have been to the facility on Garrett Road. It's a great facility, very functional. I think it's a great use, something that we need in Durham, and as you said, particularly in North Durham. So just wanted to thank you all for bringing this before us. I will be supporting it.
Thank you, Commissioner Ghosh. I'll start. Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. I'm glad that you were able to find a piece of property that would fit your needs. I just had a quick question. You mentioned the 55 to 70 jobs. I didn't know if you might be aware or not of whether or not these jobs would be able to pay a living wage over 12, 55 an hour or not.
Yes, most of them will be. What we do at Carillon is we hire people who have the right attitude and the desire to care for our seniors. And then we have an in-house training program that enables them to get licensed by the state as personal care assistants or medical technicians. There are also any number of management jobs, dietary directors, clinical directors, and some nursing positions.
That's pretty exciting. Thank you.
Commissioner Gibbs.
I just want to say ditto to Commissioner Ghosh's comments.
Commissioner Miller.
I just had a couple of points of clarification. In the development plan, your commitments refer to a main building. Do you in fact plan other buildings?
Since it's a licensed facility, the state DHSR, Division of Health Service Regulation, requires us to provide a certain square footage of storage per resident. And so there will be a separate small storage building, but it's a fraction of the size of the main building. It's a few hundred square feet.
All right, thank you. And also as a point of clarification tonight during your presentation, you've shown us photographs of buildings, and the purpose of showing those is not to commit to those, but to demonstrate what you mean by an American traditional style.
Actually, I'd be pretty comfortable committing to those because what you're looking at are existing and exact Carillon facilities. We tend to build to a prototype, and that is the building that we propose for this site. It's our single story prototype. If you wanted to drive to a close one, there is one in Hillsboro that you can see, and these are actual photographs.
I tried to let him off the hook, and he just bit down harder on it.
That's okay. If it looks any real different than that, then the company's going to be looking for a new director of development, because this is what the boss wants them to look like.
And then finally, this is a difficult site. I went over and stood on the edge of the road and looked down into it. It's hilly and has steep slopes all over it in every direction. So you're going to have to move a lot of earth around in order to make a flat place for a building that's big enough to hold 58 units. Is that right?
Well, there will be some. Fortunately, they're in the up near the front. It's sort of a bowl situation. As you step, it is a drop off of Guest Road down probably 6 to 8 feet, but it levels off, and then up on to the left, there's kind of a ridge line there.
There's a ridge line and it looks like from the topo. I didn't go onto the property. It looks from the topo that there's kind of a flat place over there. Is that where you propose to put the building?
We're going to try and keep it on the flat area for sure. And there's a lot of things we need to stay out of. One of them is the steep slopes for sure. And so, you know, we're going to try to massage it in the flattest place possible because we don't want to move any more dirt than we have to, for sure.
And Madam Chair, my final question concerns the availability of sewer utilities to this property. Can somebody show me where the sewer line runs?
I think, in fact, we just met last week with the water and sewer engineers.
If you could step to the mic.
Show you. We met last week with the water and sewer engineers, so the connection is to a line that runs to the Landis Road pump station, and I think if Tony's trying to show with the cursor, there is an existing City of Durham-owned sewer easement that goes out to, now I've forgotten the name of the street behind us, Chaucer Drive. So then that's where the sewer would run out to the line that's in Chaucer Drive.
Is there currently sewer in Guest Road?
I don't know, but it is.
There's not. All right, thank you very much.
I'm going to, before I recognize Commissioner Whitley, I'm going to check back with staff to see if there are additional comments about any of the comments that have been made.
Yes, Jamie Sonyak, Planning Department. Just quickly, you, I think Mr. Stinson mentioned a certain number of beds, 86 beds or something along that line?
Yes, 84 licensed beds.
Okay, the development plan indicates 56 rooms. You mentioned that a good portion of the units are studios, so I just wanted some clarification regarding that.
A number of the rooms will be double occupancy, in some cases because husbands and wives move in other cases because folks choose to have a roommate. Also, semi-private accommodations is clinically most advantageous for people with Alzheimer's, and so most of the time the rooms that are in the special care units for dementia care will be double occupied. So the state will make you license it for what they think your anticipated capacity is, and so it's a little confusing because it doesn't mean that there are 84 rooms, but so there are some, and several of the rooms are studios, which have two rooms on either side of a central area.
Okay, thank you. And if you are going to be committing to that certain type of architectural detail and style, that will need to be included as part of the development plan. Is that what you're indicating?
I mean, let's put this, we haven't built one that looks different yet, but if I don't have to commit to it now, I won't, but I will be happy to if this is something that the commission would like me to do. Okay, all right, then in that case, I wouldn't commit to it now, just in case for some reason I don't foresee something coming up.
That's fine, thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Now the chair recognizes Commissioner Whitley.
Yes, I'm gonna follow up on Commissioner Johnson's question about the wooded area. When I was out there, I saw deer, baby deer, and lots of wild rabbits. Have you thought about making it a little bit more appealing by putting shrubbery or something separating the wooded area from your developmental area, not to keep people, I doubt any of your patients are gonna be going that way, but to keep them out of.
So the facilities end up extensively landscaped. If you've seen the one on Garrett Road, we do an awful lot of perimeter planting and shrubbery and plantings to address it. Because of the nature of the resident population, I mean, this is a residence for the frail elderly, so all of the walking areas and outdoor areas for those residents are gonna need to be really flat. and up near the building just for resident safety. So all of our outside sidewalks will stay in tight to the building and really far away from those steep slopes because they would be a hazard. And honestly, I know I was walking out there last week myself, and it's pretty down by the river, but I think there's a nice rocky promontory out there, and I think the terrain itself is going to provide a pretty natural sort of break between the developed area and the natural heritage area. Does that work?
No, I don't think you answered my question. This, you have in the backside of your building a wooded area. And I was wondering whether you would consider putting some kind of buffer to keep any activity going, spilling into your area or into the woods.
Well, there's not going to be any activity back there just because of the residents that he spoke of. I mean, they can't manage that terrain, and so there won't be any.
I was thinking about the wildlife, their home.
Yes.
Right. I was thinking about wildlife coming into your area.
I'm not sure. I mean, it'd take a tall fence for a deer.
No, I was thinking some vegetation that would react as a barrier. Shrubbery.
We'll have to think about that. I'm not sure how we satisfy a buffer to
pray over it.
I will.
Thank you, Commissioner Whitley. Are there other questions? Are there other commissioners who would like to ask questions? If not, I'm going to, well, Commissioner Busby.
I was going to make a motion if this is the
Sounds
right
good.
Moment. Great, thank you. I move we send forward case number Z16-00031 to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second. Okay. Motion by Commissioner Busby, and second, I heard Commissioner Kitchen. Thank you. That we move item number Z16-00031, Carillon of North Durham, forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let's have a roll call, please.
Mr. Alturk?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Ghosh?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Mr. Whitley?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Mr. Busby?
Yes.
Chair Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Kinchin?
Yes.
Mr. Hornbuckle?
Yes.
Mr. Van?
Yes.
Mr. Gibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Freeman?
Yes.
Motion carries 14-0.
Thank you. Next item, we have public hearings, text amendments to the Unified Development Ordinance. The first item is design district updates. Is there anyone signed up for TC140003?
Let's talk about
it. No? Okay. Okay, I have a blank sheet. Staff.
Thank you, Michael Stock with the Planning Department, and happy Passover to everyone, second Seder night, so I hope expeditiously moving through this so you can all attend your second Seder, I appreciate that. TC 140003, you heard this as an informational item at your last meeting. This is the actual public hearing item for it. I'm going to run through a similar presentation for the purposes of the public hearing and then for the benefit of those commissioners who were not able to attend the meeting. Last month, as we discussed before, just a little history of the design districts. In 2002, the DDO, which was Downtown Design Overlay, was established, and that was the precursor for design districts, established for form-based type zoning, and introduced development in relation to the streetscape and public realm, and also introduced the idea of the sub-districts that you find in design districts, core and support districts. In 2010, the downtown design district was adopted and placed all the DDO overlay and those Bay zoning districts. And in 2012, the CED, the compact design district, was established over the 9th Street compact neighborhood tier area. And these are the maps for the DD zoning district for downtown. You see the lighter color is core, and then it gradients out as support one and support two. And then in the compact design district for 9th Street, again, the lightest is the core, and it gradients out for support one, support two. The purplish is a special district, sub-district for the pedestrian business district along 9th Street. Since the adoption of the design districts, we have had some technical corrections have been performed, but as we try to do with new initiatives or substantial initiatives that have been adopted as part of the UDO, we've constantly monitored the effectiveness and kept track of any issues that have been that come up through the ordinance provisions, and we began these updates back in 2014 along with a technical set of corrections that were performed back then also. So just as a summary, getting into the updates itself, this is not a rezoning, we're not changing the boundaries. We've come up with this reflects the amendment in front of you reflects the list of issues and considerations that have been submitted to us by a bunch of different stakeholder and other groups. It also consists of new specific street typologies that are going to be codified. There have been numerous staff and interdepartmental meetings and reviews. We've implemented focus groups, private design firm focus groups, those who have worked with the ordinance in the past and those who have not, to get different perspectives, and we brought that up last time. We've had JCCPC review of this, and then of course the info item that was presented to you, and we received comment at that meeting also. So just to get into the changes, one of the big changes that is being proposed is creating a new Article 16. Well, there's already an Article 16. That's currently the definition section. That's being bumped to Article 17. But the new Article 16 will be design districts, and that's where you'll find most of your design district regulations. One of the things that we've heard is that they'd like a more consolidated place for a lot of the regulations. We have kept the parking and landscaping requirements in their current parking and landscaping articles respectively, because it just seems to work better in terms of review, not only for staff, but also for those who are developing and the site plans and need to know the regulations. again, I'll go through the highlights. There are a lot of changes, and the report hopefully goes into a good detailed discussion of what those changes are. It's a similar report that you received back in March, and I'll highlight an additional section of it when we go through this. But as we discussed before, we're introducing new aspects of such as focusing on non-residential uses in the downtown loop and the Main Street Foster Blackwell axes, removal of design special use permits, and we believe that a lot of the changes add more flexibility and have addressed a lot of design special use permit applications that have come through so far. But we've also retained in a number of the sections, especially the newer sections such as open space and the street typologies, alternative forms of compliance where you can go for a minor special use permit, so there's still ability to address specific needs or concerns there. We are introducing new open space requirements, as we discussed, and that's in keeping with the downtown open space plan that had been recently adopted. And then we clarified and made a little more prescriptive service areas, those loading areas, emergency fire code access, those kind of areas, where they can go, or more prescribed direction as to where they can go. Getting into other sections, we've talked about the biggest changes, or how height is calculated. We went from a ratio-based format to just specific minimum, maximum feet based upon ratios, but it was just found that on both sides of the equation, those who are developing plans and those who are reviewing plans, the ratios just seem to bog people down, confuse people. So we just went with a straight minimum and maximum heights. There are some adjustments to the heights, but there are also adjustments to conform to additional provisions that you could get, so it makes those additional height provisions more meaningful if you're going to get those heights. The main revisions to the building and frontage types were taking structured parking out as a frontage type and just creating it as a standalone architectural section, recognizing that it can be a component of a building or freestanding, and then providing those architectural or design standards accordingly. Forecourts, we really got into more of the impact of the forecourt along the streetscape. Instead, right now, it's just raised court or a lighted lower court or a stoop, and it really didn't address any effect upon the streetscape. We also reduced a bit of the setback of the main structure from the street to bring the building a little bit closer to the street to create that more effective building or street wall. And then we also revised some of the general facade requirements. We heard from the focus groups that some of it was a bit too prescriptive, and it really hampered a lot of innovative design, which we kind of saw through. We took it, there's some of it was justified. I see Commissioner Miller giving a rolling his eyes. We took it for what it was, but we thought that the changes were worthwhile for what we did. Sidewalk requirements, we did tighten down on the sidewalk requirements, specifying when sidewalks or even additional sidewalk, if there's even sidewalk already there, is needed. Sidewalk is a big part of where design districts are going, not only downtown, but also the future rail stations. And right now there was a lot of flexibility of getting out of doing sidewalk or even upgrading sidewalk. Again, we discussed new street typologies. This is new for the UDO itself. It was something that was considered when they were working on the original design districts, but it was seen as a kind of a beast in its own right in terms of developing that it had been set aside for the moment. But we felt that it was a good time to at least introduce some basic street typologies that and codify them so they weren't mere recommendations through or suggested guidelines. Most of the design standards that you find here and the revisions are geared towards the regulations and the zoning that's currently in place. We didn't, some of it does look toward the future, like the new street typologies, and some of the buffer changes that we did. There weren't a lot of landscaping changes that we did, but we did add buffer standards for when you're adjacent to the suburban tier, which wasn't originally in there, because now we do have the compact neighborhood tiers. Hopefully future design districts that are adjacent to the suburban tier, even actually non-jurisdictional areas too. So that was considered. And then we did do an extensive revision to the bicycle parking standards also. We're implementing a new methodology of the types of bike parking that will be required, short-term and long-term parking. It's not something that's new out there. A lot of different ordinances utilize that standard. But we're going to implement it through the design districts. And a lot of this, not just bike parking, but some of these other, like the new street typologies or even some of the other items, we'll see how they work out in the design districts. And if they can work out in other parts of Durham, too, we'll try to implement them there, too. Bicycle parking is one aspect where it might be a good idea to start taking a look at short-term and long-term parking in a broader sense throughout Durham, not just in the design districts. That's all I have for that. I do want to mention that I did receive some comments, particularly from Commissioner Bryan. Thank you very much. And in the good job. And those have been articulated. Some of those have been articulated in the staff report as some of the changes that we made. There are a couple other adjustments that we made based upon additional staff review. If you have any questions about those, I'll be happy to answer that, or if you want me to go into detail about it, I'd be happy to. There are minimal changes. There was nothing substantial, but we thought it was good. There was one, it was brought up at the hearing about ADA accessibility. We felt that was an important notion, but it was something that would be applicable to development throughout Durham, not just a specific type of development within design districts. So we added it to a general section, general performance standards in the UDO, and that's why it's there, not in specifically designed districts. Other items, adjustments to self-storage, limited use standards, suggesting maybe allowing for a little bit of office space for self-storage at ground level. We thought that was a reasonable idea, so we implemented that too. And there was a couple others in there too. I know I walked through it rather quickly, but I'll be happy to answer any questions.
As I indicated, I have no individuals who have signed up to speak, so I'm going to close. This is a public hearing, so I'm going to close it and then give commissioners an opportunity to ask questions. I start to my right. Commissioner Alter, Commissioner Ghosh, Commissioner Whitley. Anybody else? Commissioner Miller? Nobody else? Okay. Commissioner Alter.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Michael, for your presentation. I had a few questions. The first was about the height provisions in section 16.3.4. So I'm looking at, so if someone has it, the affordable housing provision, for example, if you have at least 15% of units meet the definition of affordable housing dwelling, you can add 60 feet right to the height in the core of the downtown district. But I was comparing that to the compact neighbor, I guess the compact district, and you only have 45 feet extra that you can add to the top of the building. I was just curious why the difference between the six, between the two districts in that case. Just because you expect higher buildings in downtown?
Exactly. We're maintaining the same proportional height requirements for downtown versus compact design districts.
Okay, yeah. That's it. Okay. My other questions or comments were all about bicycle lanes and parking. And these are based on my conversations with members of the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission. The first is that they appreciate a lot of the changes made, including the requirement for long-term parking, the painting bike lanes a different color in areas of conflict, and that the primary street type requires bike lanes now. They did have a few suggestions, and I related to the primary street type. The first was whether the bike lanes in that primary street type can be painted a highly visible color, because a lot of times, so that lane is right next to parked cars, and oftentimes people are not aware, and they open the door and hit, I guess, cyclists. And the second suggestion was requiring a physical barrier in the 2-foot buffer between the bicycle lane and the parked lane. And then there was a third kind of question about whether there was consideration for parking for bicycles with trailers, something that's becoming more popular, I guess. So if you had any thoughts on any of those, I would appreciate it.
I don't have any thoughts on them particularly now. I can't commit that. What I would ask is actually just email with me those comments, and we can take a look at that.
Okay.
I thought we have... So we're talking about the primary street type?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so the primary street type, there is already a 2-foot buffer that's
right.
built into it. And bike lane and the buffers, there's already a physical requirement within the buffers.
Okay.
It's either going to be a raised median or delineated with striping and vertical bollards.
Okay.
So that's already in there.
Okay.
And bicycle lanes shall be painted green at areas of conflict, not limited to intersections and driveways.
Right.
So
I guess one of the comments was that in a street like this they would consider this an area of conflict just because of maybe the density, and
we can take a look. We can definitely take a look
so
at
I
that.
Can
yeah definitely
okay.
sure
okay
sure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just had a question about, so this is creating a new Section 16, and I'm wondering how, future design districts, how that Section 16 will relate to that. I don't necessarily have comments about how these new standards apply to the current districts, but, my concern is some of the design districts that are coming on board I don't think that they would fit with what is being proposed here. A lot of the design elements, for example, can severely limit your ability to do certain types of uses, such as a gas station or something, which, like in the Lee Village, it's not compact at all, and would probably warrant a gas station somewhere in there. And I think it, I think these proposed elements would make something like that difficult. And there's probably some other uses as well. So I'm wondering how this new section will apply or interact with future design districts.
And that's a very good point. And I can't remember if I brought it up at the last meeting, but I know I definitely didn't raise it here. Is that when we go and look at the, each individual design districts, we are going to take a look at what's already on the books and see, and also determine what are the unique issues with those districts and come up with either revisions that might be applicable to that and even all the design districts, or additional standards that might be applicable to the unique issues that are raised within those other compact neighborhoods, whether it's just additional provisions for uses that might be limited to a certain compact neighborhood tier or something like that, or even there might be even new special sub-districts that might need to be developed too, which will have their own host of regulations too. So that's a very good point. The regulations and the updates really are geared towards the current effective, currently mapped, and we felt that that was important to get really to get it up to speed and get a new good baseline to work with. And then when we go into Patterson Place and Lee Village and MLK and those other areas, Alston and such, that unique situations, we wholly anticipate that some of those might require some additional or revised standards. Some might not, or it might be very minimal. Some might be a little bit more substantial.
Right, so ultimately you do anticipate creating guidelines for future districts that are specific to those districts.
It's possible if the issues, if the concerns warrant it. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Yeah. And then, you know, just on the kind of in the same line, and I don't really have a particular use in mind, but you know, I think that some of the requirements in these design districts can have a tendency to limit, certain types of uses. And the things I'm concerned about are more like, are things that you might actually want or need in a design district, you know, like a hospital. I'm not suggesting that a hospital couldn't be built under these mm-hmm. guidelines, but you know, in my mind, there's probably some things about a hospital that mm-hmm. would be, you know, done better if they didn't have to adhere to these guidelines. And so, you know, I just imagine that in the future that some of these uses mm-hmm. might run contrary to what's in here and maybe should be looked at that time. It's kind of hard to anticipate what those will be right now, but I appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, sure. Definitely.
Thank you. Commissioner Whitley?
Yes. Well, you answered one of my questions, but I have another one. As I was looking through this, I was trying to we seemed to, in our past development of downtown and urban corridors, we missed opportunities to develop parking areas as if the future plan is for everybody to either be riding bikes and walking, you know? And I don't think that's going to be the case for the next 20, 25 years. And given that you're going to have a population growth all over the inner corridors, the urban downtown area, and they're going to drive cars. And so how do you, did y'all discuss this at all?
Yeah, and the only thing that these regulations do in terms of, and we didn't actually touch the parking requirements at all, so we're talking about existing regulations, is that adjust the minimums required. So we're not prohibiting parking. In fact, there's plenty of parking that is being proposed with much of the development that's going on downtown. And even the city is proposing parking structures. So the issue of parking is a hot topic right now for downtown, and it's a combination of the what is the role of the city in providing parking, and the role of and how does existing parking and how people maximize out maybe existing vacant parking that is on private property, how do you do shared leases, that kind of thing. So you're not planning for parking, but you recognize that parking is a component of development. The compact neighborhood tiers have minimum requirements, and we're not touching those. There are maximums, but there's even ways to go above maximums. So there's nothing that's really prohibiting parking. It's just saying that we're not emphasizing parking as much, because we need to reflect that we are want to become a little bit more multimodal in our ways of thinking in the future.
Okay, I would ask the question, how smart is that?
I think it's good planning that we recognize that cars are not necessarily should be the driving force for development in certain areas of Durham.
Given that you're gonna have, even right now, the population that we have downtown, right? When events take place, it is terrible. You know, I mean, it's as if no one was thinking about how do you manage transportation. You know, so you're talking about in the future that these things are gonna take care of itself. That's not the case.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner Whitley. Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I wanted to ask specifically with regard to the 9th Street Compact Neighborhood Tier and Design District, which is the only non-downtown place where we've actually realized this process all the way through. In that district, we created a tier-specific sub-district, which is the pedestrian, which accommodated, which was meant to accommodate and preserve what was already there in terms of the commercial district on the east side of 9th Street for that one block. And so these changes in the regulations will not make any adjustment to that. The other observation I wanted to throw out, in that same district, we had some, again, district-specific use regulations with regard to what can go in the various sub-districts, and these changes will not make adjustment to those.
That's correct.
And so as we go forward and we look at design districts for the other compact neighborhood tiers, it is, as it was with 9th Street, it is possible with each of those tiers, as we go through the design district planning process, we may identify the need for special sub-districts or special use requirements. It's even conceivable, I suppose, that we might come up with additional or different building frontage types for the form-based regulations in those districts.
Absolutely.
And as we bring those on, we will add sections to this article of the UDO that will be district specific.
Absolutely.
So that's how that will function in the future. I also wanted to take this opportunity to observe how these districts function with regard to the creation of future parking in the 9th Street area. There wasn't a lot of parking, but when we imposed compact tier regulations and then ultimately design district regulations, which so reordered the way the warp and the woof of the regulations there, we've seen a dramatic increase in development intensity, and that increase in development intensity has brought with it, because intensifying the development, the new developments have brought in lots of new parking. We have four new parking decks. Now they're private decks, but each of these new projects has supplied its own parking in a way that the surface parking or the public parking or available private parking that was already there never could have done. And I think we're going to see the same phenomenon everywhere. So I do believe that while it's great to diversify some of our transportation expectations, Ultimately, I believe this design district process promotes parking, especially structured parking, in a way that nothing else does in the UDO outside the design district planning process. Is that correct?
Yeah, I couldn't argue with any of that.
Thank you. Pardon me, I did have another question. Would you explain one more time how the regulations with regard to the support to sub-district will perform as opposed to the way they perform now, especially with regard to building height?
That's a good question. And I believe we did talk about it last time. So we are adjusting the height requirements for the S2 when they are adjacent to non-design district areas. And most of those are established urban neighborhoods. We realize that there needed to be some massing and scale contact sensitiveness to that. So measuring, I believe, 75 feet in on the property or the site, you're restricted to a lower height, 35 feet. I don't have it in front of me, but it's detailed in there. I think it's around 35 feet. And then you can go up the height after you get outside of that 75 feet. So it's trying to be context sensitive to the neighboring, the adjacent neighborhoods around
it. So currently the base height limitation in S2 is 45 feet, is that correct?
I think it's might even be, let me just get to that section so I don't go off.
I'm sorry, I don't remember.
No, it's fine.
It's somewhere around there.
It was 45 feet, yes. So we dropped it down to 35 feet in the CD, and in downtown support two is 50, and we dropped that also down to 35 feet.
In the 70-foot zone?
In that 75-foot zone, right.
75-foot
yes,
zone.
Correct.
But outside the 75-foot zone, it remains 45 feet.
Then you can go up to that.
And how do the height bonuses function in the S2 under the new regulations?
It would apply to either of those, but the height bonuses are pretty much limited to affordable housing.
Right. And all right, thank you very much. That's all the questions I had. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Are there additional questions from, Commissioner Gibbs? Commissioner Freeman, did I see? Yes, okay. Commissioner Gibbs and then Commissioner Freeman. Go ahead.
I just have a couple of comments about, I've got a lot of comments or questions, but anyway, the first one has to do with the bike lanes. And we do have a lot of our residents that use bike lanes, and I have stressed to people that I know of on the biking committees and just general conversation about the safety issue. And I mentioned something about I wish there was some way to provide a physical barrier between the bike lanes and traffic lanes, not only for their safety, but for the liability issues of the drivers. That's just an idea I think that we should try to work toward, and to be very careful where we put these bike lanes. Sometimes the traffic gets squeezed down, and it really scares me that I'm going to come up on someone riding a bike that I didn't even see until I'm right on them. And another part of it, and I will close my comments after this, I wish there was something in here that would encourage or almost require bikers to have a big enough backlight and front light that can be seen. I have almost run over a couple of bikers that they had a little light blinking, but it's about that size. You know what I'm talking about, and it's blinking. I hope that will be part of the thinking in the safety issues with bikes and the people who use them. And I do myself a time or two. But that's all my comments right now.
Thank you, Commissioner Gibbs. Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. Just a quick question. I just wanted to get some clarification. The notification area is not mentioned. I just want to make sure it's in line, or if there's been any changes to it.
I'm sorry, notification area?
So in this pre-application, well, in section 3.2.5, the notification and public hearings, the summary of the notice required, a notice you're listing when it's required and what method is required, but it doesn't say the area that would be covered, because I'm assuming it's not going to be the whole area. The whole district receives notice, but I just wanted to.
Oh, that's only in there. Nothing's changing. We're only taking out design or, because there's no design special use permit, so we're just removing that term.
Okay.
There's no change in the notification area. No.
Okay, thank you. If there are no additional comments, the chair will entertain a motion for design district updates.
Madam Chair, I move that the Planning Commission send the proposed design district updates proposed in TC 14-3 forward to the City Council, and this will also go to the Board of Commissioners?
Yes, sir.
And to the Board of Commissioners with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner Whitley that we move the design district updates, item number TC 140003, forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand.
Motion carries 14 to 0.
Are there any additional staff comments? Okay, he's just there. All right. Next item that we have is airport overlay, TC 170003. Staff, please.
Thank you. Michael Stock again with the Planning Department. Let me get to that agenda item there. One moment, please. Thank you. Yes, TC 170003 is a privately initiated amendment application by submitted by Thomas Johnson Jr. For Communication Tower Group LLC to amend Section 4.8 of the UDO, the airport overlay with subdistricts A60 and A65. In short, the only substantial change that is being proposed is to the allowable uses within that overlay, and this overlay, as you see on your map, affects only two parcels in Durham County. The allowable uses currently are for residential and agricultural only. The request is to allow consideration for utilities and all the uses that would be allowed under utilities, including cell towers, and that is a primary concern of the applicant. The request, this does not change the permissibility of the base zoning district, so if a use permit is required for the base zoning district, it's going through a use permit. If it is not allowed in the base zoning, it is not allowed at all. So it is still deferring to the base zoning, it's just adding a permissibility, allowing consideration of that use as allowed by the use table. It has been reviewed by the county attorney's office, the city attorney's office, even though it's all in the county at this point, and has been sent to the RDU authority, and they had no concerns of this whatsoever. The other changes that you see in there are all technical in nature. When I was taking a look at this, and quite honestly, I don't deal with the airport overlay that much. There's not a lot of concern to deal with the airport overlay, but when we were reading through it, a lot of the text was a little confusing and referencing areas A and B, and that was a holdover, I believe, from the merge zoning ordinance. Quite honestly, it gets you there, but it says A60 and A65 deal with decibel levels, primarily. There's very little in the actual regulations that deal with decibel levels. It is all restrictions on height and lighting and uses and such, and also requirements for FAA and RDU approvals. Areas A and B, again, are a holdover, and it's confusing as how that relates to the sub-districts A60 and A65, so just clarifying that language. The applicant is here, and I believe he has signed up to speak, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. The public hearing is open for comment. At this time, I have Tom Johnson listed to speak. Welcome.
Yes, I'm Tom Johnson. I'm an attorney with the law firm of Nexen Pruitt at 4141 Park Lake Avenue, Suite 200 in Raleigh. I would just concur with the staff report. I am the applicant. We're in agreement in terms of the changes, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have with respect to the proposed amendment.
I have no additional individuals to speak for this item, so I'm going to close the public hearing and give the commissioners an opportunity to speak and ask questions. I will start to my right, Commissioner Al Turk. Okay, and to my left, no one. You're all alone.
Thank you. This is to staff. To Michael. This is maybe not the place to do it, but why have it to where we say what is permitted rather than what's prohibited, as it was in the MZO, I guess? Rather than continuing to add permitted uses, why not go back to the way that it was in the MZO, which is all uses are accepted acceptable except for the following? Is that?
I'm sorry, I'm not seeing where you're.
So here we're proposing to add one, use case, right? That we're proposing to add utilities as a permitted use, right? But why not? So on the first page here, it says the list of in the merged zoning ordinance.
Oh, okay.
It had it to where it was all uses are acceptable except for the following. I'm just curious.
I don't know the reason actually why it switched over. I was just sticking to the current format. I didn't think about switching it back again, quite honestly. It wasn't a consideration.
May I answer that
question?
Yes,
the chair recognizes Commissioner Miller.
So with base zoning districts, we have a table of permitted uses, and we say these uses are allowed. And then when you add an overlay to it, overlay districts function differently because more often than not, they are districts which add restrictions to the base district. They usually don't add permission. So when you adjust the regulations in an overlay district, you're more often than not either making them tougher by taking out more allowed uses, or you are allowing allowed uses that you had taken out originally. And that's actually what's happening here, is we are adjusting this overlay district adds restrictions to the base underlying district, which in this case is RR. And so what we're doing is adjusting those additional restrictions to make them a little less restrictive by one identified use. And that might account for the way it's worded.
Thank you, Commissioner Miller. Are there additional comments? If not, the chair will entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we send the changes proposed in the airport overlay change in TC 17-3 forward to the City Council and Board of County Commissioners with a favorable recommendation.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Miller. Second by Commissioner Al Turk, that we move airport overlay changes forward, item number TC170003, forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 14-0.
Thank you. And the next item we have, staff, outdoor sales, temporary uses, item number TC170004.
Again, thank you, Michael Stock with the Planning Department. This is a staff-initiated technical amendment to temporary outdoor sales. Issue had come up. Current text restricts the area of a temporary outdoor sales to 400 square feet, but it failed to take into consideration that there are some seasonal uses that require larger areas. So it does two things. Recognizes those seasonal uses, specifically Christmas tree sales, pumpkin sales, and fireworks. And then also it does eliminate a redundant text. Item B, you see crossed out, that same text is found at the head of the temporary use section. We felt it wasn't necessary to be redundant specifically in this section. There was at JCCPC where they did review this, and Commissioner Busby was there, and he can correct my memory or statements if I get it wrong, but there was questions about nonprofit sales markets, specifically TROSA and maybe some others that come up. And we did look into it further, and it was pretty much determined also at that meeting that those are either handled through, they have a permanent site plan approval for that, or they're handled through a special events temporary use permit. It's a different section within the temporary uses that actually specifies nonprofits and markets allowed for those nonprofits. So those were the issues that were raised at JCCPC. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Since this is a public hearing, we'll have to open and close it and give the commissioners now an opportunity to speak. Are there any commissioners who would like to speak on outdoor sales temporary uses? To my right, outdoor. Commissioner Freeman.
Just for clarity, so this does not limit the for-profit businesses from having a food truck on their property?
I mean, No.
Commissioner Busby.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I would just echo that we had a good conversation at the Joint City-County Planning Committee. Michael did a great job. This is well thought out. I'm going to vote to approve.
If there are no additional comments, the chair will entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we send forward the proposed changes to the outdoor sales temporary uses proposed in TC 17-4 to the City Council and Board of County Commissioners with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller. I did not hear that second. Commissioner Van, thank you. That we move item outdoor sales temporary uses proposed changes to item number TC 170004 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 14 to 0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The public hearing text amendments to the Durham Comprehensive Plan. Staff is here. There's none.
Hold on. The next item should be an item that was added under adjustments, under unfinished business.
Okay. So we go none. So there's something under unfinished business. Thank you. That's correct.
There are two items. Sarah Young with the Planning Department. The first is approval of revised minutes from your January 10th meeting. You should have those at your places.
Yes.
May I ask what the revision was?
It's highlighted in yellow, I believe. And hold on, I don't have one there.
I see the highlighting, but I'm not sure I understand the change.
And the corrections. And it was the other thing to the corrections.
I'm being advised by my very capable staff that in general the project description was wrong.
Madam Chair, I move that we revise the minutes to our January meeting as proposed by the staff.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller is second by Commissioner Busby that we approve the corrections as provided by staff. Those were the January 10th minutes. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 14 to 0.
And the next item we have is a work plan.
Correct. As you all recall, I think we've had the work program on your agenda a couple of times since maybe December or so, the most recent time being February. At the time, though, we failed to get a formal recommendation from this body, and we do need that in order to bring it to the elected officials. I have placed a clean copy, and you'll see it's so clean that it's a month ahead of time. It's the May draft, which is the draft that will go to the elected officials. I want to just to remind everyone, there have been a couple of minor changes, and if you don't mind, I'll very quickly run through them. We have essentially five new work program items slated for next year. The first is on page 11, item 4.1.9, Pocket Neighborhoods, and that is to explore some more compact ways to develop and redevelop properties. Page 11 of the attachment, the second attachment, the full description. The next two items are on page 13, 429 and 4210. This is the South Square MLK Compact Design District and Lee Village. We committed last year to the elected officials that we would initiate all five compact design districts within a two-year time period. So this would be initiating the last two remaining design districts beginning next year. Then on page 14, item 431, Historic Preservation Fund Grant Administration for an update to our city and county architectural inventory. And then the last item, which is really, it's on page 15, item 4.7.1. We have long used interns for a variety of projects. This year, our elected officials at the Joint City County Planning Committee asked us to formalize our internship program. And so we have done that. It is now listed in our work program. And at their request, we have added a little project for an analysis of further regulatory barriers to affordable housing. So we hope to have some group of interns working on that. And I'm happy to entertain any questions.
Thank you for the clarification. This is a document that we've had a couple of times. I'm going to check to see if there are any additional questions by commissioners. Commissioner Whitley and Commissioner Freeman. We'll start with Commissioner Whitley.
Yes, thank you. I'm always amazed how much this planning department is able to get through their work plan and how comprehensive it is. But 32 years ago, and five different development plans for East Durham. We have asked for some revisions in our quilt of different zonings. And 32 years later, we're still on the back burner. I thought it was brought up in our January meeting by Commissioner Miller. At that time, I thought there was a group conscious that this needed more attention. And 32 years later, we're voting on a work plan that does not include that.
So if I may respond, Commissioner Whitley, we did hear you. In fact, this is also a same or very similar to request to what this body made last year. And again, we currently do not have, given the other priorities that have been assigned to us by the elected officials, the planning department does not have the capacity to initiate that project yet. We will be glad in our staff report or our cover memo to the elected bodies when this moves forward to once again, just like we did last year, enumerate that is a concern of this body. And if they wish to change things in our work program, reassign work, et cetera, we will certainly entertain that, but we do not currently have the capacity to take on a project like that, given the other priorities they've already set for us.
Yes, I understand that there are priorities, but we have 38,000 residents, voters. that live in East Durham, the downtown tier, northeast central Durham. No bank, not even one doctor office. We've just lost a hardware store. And we have business, small, many focused business areas where you have 14 and 15 different zonings in two or three blocks. You know, it stands as an impediment, it stands as a barrier to smart growth. And yet, if it's not the planning department's fault, it's, according to you, it's the elected officials' fault, then I'll state for the record, this is wrong. We pay our taxes in East Durham just like everybody else. You know, and to be put off for 32 years is a little much. Thank you.
Madam Chair, if I may, last year the one thing that we were able to do in response to the concern, the broader concern brought last year, was to add an item to the work program 4.12 on page 17, which continues this year since it's a multi-year project, to reconsider the Anger Driver area and potentially put the commercial infill zoning district there as a small kind of start to this larger project. That project is underway. Scott Whiteman supervises the work on that project, and he can give you a brief status. I will tell you that going out and reaching out into the community, we have heard concerns from the community about moving forward with any zoning changes in that area. So I will defer to Scott.
Thank you, Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. I appreciate Reverend Whitley's comments, Commissioner Whitley's right, and I would like to offer some type of solution in this, in that I realize that it's not, you know, this work plan is like 15, 20 pages long.
That's right.
And if there's a way to identify neighborhoods that have had this level of neglect in zoning, so that this priority, because I do realize there's scoring, there's methods in which you choose what needs to move forward outside of just city councils or county commissioners' suggestions. I would like to include an environmental justice impact statement, and I would be more than happy to send some verbiage on that, which would allow staff to navigate equitable development planning moving forward. So that it takes into account the impact. And I recognize the comment that you made about, you know, the community itself saying they're concerned about the zoning moving forward because there's some concerns about gentrification. I think that this would help so that you could start the conversation back up because there's some fear.
Yeah. And one thing that we could do, I failed to mention, the third attachment is a Part C future projects, which is a non-binding list. It's not really part of our work program, but it's kind of a holding cell for things that have been identified typically through the comprehensive plan, although lately, since our comprehensive plan keeps getting more and more out of date, there are other non-comp plan contemplated projects that have been added to this future projects list. This is certainly an item that could be added to that list that may bring it more into the forefront of people's thinking as we move forward. So that is something that we could do.
Madam Chairman.
Thank you. Yes, Chair recognizes Commissioner Whitley.
I need to add South Central. The two largest low-wealth neighborhoods, communities, are the two that are neglected. And need that attention. I echo Ms. Freeman's suggestion that we need to take note of what hasn't been done in low-wealth neighborhoods and to come up with some type of recommendation. that will move us forward. 32 years is a long time. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Whitley. And I did hear staff indicate that they would include the additional comments that were made here tonight as a part of that. Not necessarily in the work plan, but certainly as a part of the package. Any additional comments from staff? Okay, thank you. Then the chair will entertain a motion. Wait a minute. Oh, I'm sorry. This
next month.
No, we accept this. Madam Chair, if it's appropriate at this time, I'm going to move that the Planning Commission send forward to the City Council and the Board of Commissioners a recommendation that they approve the fiscal year 18 work program for the Planning Department. But to that, I would like to say that we would like to append to it our concern that there that the South Central and East Durham areas are overdue for a thoroughgoing planning review, and that add that comment to the work plan as we send it forward. But the base motion is to approve the work plan as submitted.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller that we move the Durham City County Planning Department FY18 work plan with additional comments that have been made here today. Second by Commissioner Bryan that we send the item forward as indicated. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay.
Motion carries 13 to 1.
Thank you. Well, there is additional new business on the bike walk implementation plan. Is that, yes.
Correct.
There we go.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Commissioners. My name is Brian Poole. I'm with the Transportation Department. I wanted to give you sort of a brief summary and announcement about our bike walk plan update, and I'm happy to come back and provide a more comprehensive update if you see appropriate at a future time. But since last May, we have been in the process of updating the bicycle and pedestrian plans for the city, and we've combined both of those plans that were both 10 years old into one document. So here it is. It was released earlier this month, and it's out now for public comment. We're taking comments from the public through April 28th, and we're hoping to bring this forward to City Council for adoption at their May 15th meeting. And just to give you a brief summary of what is in the plan, we have looked at, so the first section of the plan looks at the previous plans, what's been accomplished, existing policies, and we took a broad look at all the needs in Durham, and so we had the public help us identify places that they wanted to see bike facilities or pedestrian facilities. We found that there was more than 400 miles of sidewalk needs in the city, more than 400 miles of bike facility needs in the city, and close to 500 intersections that needed improvement. So this plan is an implementation-focused plan. So once we identified all those needs, we had a series of prioritization processes that took that down to 25 corridor projects, 25 intersection projects, and 25 sidewalk gap projects that we think will inform our work plan for the short to medium term future. And so those projects are identified in this plan and have recommendations tied to them, but they do not, it's not a comprehensive look at, sort of like the Durham Walks plan had a list of every project and a ranking beside those. This plan does not have that. But it is implementation focused, and at the end of the plan, there are 25 topics that look at everything from making regional connections to UDO recommendations. So. There are some good things in there and looking at what other peer cities are doing so that we can follow their lead. And we are having a public meeting on this plan. There's an open house April 18th, next Tuesday from 4:30 to 6:30. That's at the Temple Building. And so you all are welcome to attend. And the plan is, it's on the transportation's website, but it's also at DurhamBikeWalkPlan.com. So feel free to take a look. And I'm happy to answer any questions you all have at this time. I'm also happy to come back and give a more formal presentation if you see appropriate.
Are there any comments? Okay, Commissioner Johnson.
Not to belabor our time, but just a quick question. You say that the plan is basically an implementation plan. Is it connected to any financing plan? Like how we're going to pay for implementing the plan?
Yeah, so yes, City Council has allocated $15 million for sidewalks coming out of the adoption of this plan. So we are actually already working with Public Works and coordinating on some projects that have been identified in here because we are wanting to implement this plan. That's the focus. So it was a process of balancing critical need and then constructability of these projects. I know that there's been some mention tonight about sidewalks that are really difficult to build, and that's hampered us in the past when we've had a really expensive sidewalk projects. So we have looked at that, and we're hoping to really focus on implementation in the coming years.
Are there any additional questions?
Madam Chair, I would like to just make one comment in addition to that. The sidewalks that need upgrading also benefit the disabled public to maintain their accessibility to around town. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Any additional questions or comments? Thank you.
Thank you.
Update sheet. Are there any questions you'd like to ask about this information? If not, we have reached the end of our agenda. Any questions? Everybody has it?
I was just saying this is very helpful.
Yes, I wanted the staff to know that we appreciate receiving this. Thank you so much. I don't have anything else. Motion to adjourn.
Second.
It's like all hard as magical.